To our education officials, policymakers, teachers, school heads, researchers, students, and our participants to today's webinar, a wonderful morning from Bangkok, Thailand. Today, we join the rest of the world in celebrating the International Day of Education through a webinar in line with this year's theme, to invest in people, prioritize education. We are beyond excited to learn from the insightful discussions of our speakers this morning on how we can further put at the top of our list, education. I am Emil John Columna Centillas, Policy and Planning Specialist of CIMEA Secretariat, and I will be your moderator this morning. To commence our webinar, may I call on the Director of CIMEA Secretariat, Dr. Ethel Agnes Pasco Valenzuela, for her welcome message. Dr. Valenzuela, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Emil. Happy International Day of Education. To our distinguished speakers, education policymakers joining us today, our education leaders, beloved teachers, school heads, students, our dear participants, a wonderful morning from Bangkok, Thailand. Today, we celebrate the International Day of Education, a day where we affirm the role of education in the development of people, communities, society, and the world. This year's theme is to invest in people, prioritize education. Indeed, if we want the holistic development of people in an ever-changing world, education is the key, and education should be prioritized, especially now as we address the challenges of a post-pandemic world. We are also heading towards achieving the new social contract introduced during the Transforming Education Summit to support the UN Sustainable Development Goals, particularly SDG Goal number 4. The emphasis during the Transforming Education Summit, both in Paris and in New York for the pre-summit and the summit itself, gained support from 130 countries committed to transforming education and accelerating efforts to ensure inclusive, equitable, quality, and lifelong learning opportunities provided to all. This morning, in this special webinar, we have invited experts, those who are really on top of transforming education in our region, to discuss how we now operationalize the commitments made in that summit, looking at and learning from key commitments and strategies of countries in transforming education. We also zoom in into specific examples from countries on how they are accelerating and strengthening their commitments in reimagining their education systems after the pandemic. We also have speakers and experts who will discuss concerns, key challenges on education, such as from early childhood care and education, greening education, and the like. Our discussions will highlight why all stakeholders need to prioritize these concerns. We are also happy today that at the forefront of the Transforming Education Summit is the youth engagement, very critical, discussing and expounding on the Youth Declaration in Transforming Education, which, by the way, is a product of global consultations and online surveys where youth everywhere in the world participated and their comments and aspirations were put forward. We believe that through this presentation, we will be able to put more focus in different local and global initiatives in transforming and prioritizing education, building on the task commitments, the Youth Declaration, and UNESCO Bangkok leading us with CIMEO in this global initiative. Emanating from the test, the webinar would like to think about new solutions because there are new issues coming out, action points from various experiences and expertise and diverse contexts, with the hope that all of us stakeholders will continue to prioritize and invest in education. We welcome you to this webinar, and we look forward to learning from one another. You can give your comments in the chat box, and thank you very much for joining us. We hope to have a productive and very engaging webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Valenzuela, for reminding us how education is key to the development of individuals, communities, and the world, and for providing us an overview for today's webinar. We are honored to be joined this morning by the Chief of Section for Inclusive Quality Education of UNESCO Bangkok to discuss Transforming Education Agenda from Commitments to Action. In her current capacity, she oversees major work of the section, including the SDG 4 Education 2030 Regional Coordination, Education Policy Planning and Management, Inclusive Education, Multilingual and Mother Tongue Education, ECCE, as well as Health Education and Well-being, among others. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our first speaker, Ms. Margaret Sachs Israel. Ms. Israel, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Emil, and thank you very much for inviting me to this very important celebration. And so I'd like to start by welcoming all the participants to this webinar on the International Day for Education, which is, of course, very important. It's an important day, first of all, to celebrate education and to really recall the importance of it. But it's also a day, and I think that is even more important, to remind ourselves yet again of the urgency to take action to ensure that education is really at the forefront of the political agendas globally, regionally, nationally, as has been already said and shown very, very clearly in TESS and also at the national level. So let's take this opportunity of the International Day of Education to remind ourselves, and this is what I'm going to try to do during my presentation, what has been discussed at TESS, what are the commitments that have been taken, and then how are countries planning to take them forward, and what is the international community planning to do in order to support them in this manner. So this is the outline of how I am planning to present this. First of all, to recall the outcomes of TESS, the global initiatives that have been launched at TESS, but also the commitments that have been taken by governments at national level. This is really the heart and soul of what TESS is all about. And then this will be followed by a quick overview of the TESS follow-up strategies and what is planned to accelerate the progress of SDG 4 to really move from commitment to action at country level. And finally, what the international community and the regional coordination mechanism here in the Asia Pacific region is planning to support countries in order to follow up activities. So in terms of the outcomes of TESS, let us just recall that the year 2022 was really a year of major boost for education as such. For the Asia Pacific region, we started with a high level regional conference, the Asia Pacific Regional Education Ministers Conference of SDG4, that looked already at the need for learning recovery and transforming education, very much fed into the national consultations that then happened afterwards. On transforming education at national level, followed by the pre-summit in Paris, and then finally TESS at global level, which really represents the most important gathering on education since decades, and a clear commitment to put transforming education at the highest level. Next one, please. So what are the key outcomes, as I already said? Let's just recall what the key outcomes are of this very important gathering. So first of all, it's really a high-level political commitment by different partners across sectors to engage action at the country level and a global movement to transform education. And as Dr. Zettler in the beginning, with youth as central actors. And that's very important to remind ourselves because they will remain to be involved in the implementation of TESS. We also know that there is a vision statement from the UN Secretary General that I'll get back to, national statements of commitments. In terms of the region, there are 29 national statements of commitments that have been submitted to TESS, but many more consultations that have been undertaken, and then calls to action and the TESS global initiatives that I will also speak to. Next one. Okay, so in terms of the vision statement, what are the key messages in the vision statement of the UN Secretary General? First of all, he sets out the principles for transformation, and then he calls upon member states and the global public to join efforts and elevate education to the top of the agenda. It is very important, he says that throughout in his vision statement, it's not just countries, but it's really everyone that needs to join hands and efforts to implement this. Otherwise, it will not be possible to reach our very ambitious goal. He also says that we have to rethink the purpose and content of education in the 21st century. And here he talks about four different areas in which we should be rethinking the purpose. And so his vision speaks about learning to learn, referring to the need to equip learners with the foundational literacy and numeracy skills, but also digital and scientific skills to really improve learning outcomes and tackle the learning crisis. He also refers to the need to start early and the importance of early childhood care and education. The next point is learning to live together. This refers to, on the one hand, to really become responsible citizens that are able to live peacefully and sustainably, respecting also nature in their communities and their countries and in the world. The next one is about learning to do. That refers to a rapidly changing society, economy, and world that requires true implementation of lifelong learning and flexible pathways that allows learners to relearn, unlearn, reskill, upskill, and re-engage with education systems in different ways throughout their lives. And the final one is learning to be. So this is really about the instillment of the values and capacities that are required by human beings to lead a meaningful life. So in order to get there, he then says that the education system has to be transformed in four main areas. The first one is to ensure a learning environment that supports the development of all learners. Here, he refers to the importance of learning environments to be safe, inclusive, healthy, and stimulating, and importantly, to address all forms of discrimination and exclusion. The next one importantly talks about teachers being at the heart of education, being at the heart of transformation. But teachers also have to transform themselves and become agents of change. So they cannot continue as they used to do. So in order to become knowledge producers and facilitators, they must be trained and they must be empowered. So apart from teacher capacity building, he also says that their autonomy must be broadened. We've seen in many of the COVID-19 experiences that an empowered teacher is also a teacher that is able to take decisions on curriculum implementation and adaptation himself, but he needs to be empowered to do that. Harnessing the digital revolution is, of course, key. But we have to remember that digital transformation is a means to achieving education, and it should be done for the benefit of public education. So this reaches from, of course, providing universal access and connectivity to digital through digital literacy to providing high quality digital learning platforms and content. And finally, financing education is key theme. We have to invest more. Education is constantly underfunded, but this is not enough. It's not just about more. It's about investing more equitably, meaning that investments should and must reach the most excluded and vulnerable ones, and more efficiently in the sense that when we invest, we must, this investment must produce the expected learning outcomes. Next one, please. So now let's take a look at the National Statements of Commitment to Transform Education Systems that were submitted by member states from Asia Pacific. Here, we undertook an analysis, and this is a summary of the 29 statements that we have. So you can see that countries all committed to COVID-19 learning recovery, but also with a focus very much on the most vulnerable learners. So the first step, of course, is to re-engage learners and to ensure their return to school and ensure that those that are at risk of dropping out are really provided with the right support to remain in school. Next one is to look at addressing learning loss, but also importantly to support socio-emotional well-being of learners and teachers. Addressing educational exclusion was a key theme across all the 29 statements because there is a clear acknowledgement that COVID-19 hit the vulnerable learners the most, and therefore this is something that countries really want to address going forward by prioritizing the disadvantaged and marginalized learners in education in the future. Transforming the teaching profession is also a key theme. More than 97% of the statements talk about the need to focus on teachers and to support pre and in-service training and professional development. Interesting enough, also the rethinking of education for countries meant that their curriculum would need to be reformed and renewed, which had basically two components. The first one was about foundational literacy and numeracy skills, but it was also about competency-based curriculum that would really help learners to acquire 21st century or transversal skills that they require in life. Digital learning and transformation was another key, speaking about the areas that I just mentioned, reaching from universal connectivity to digital resources and platforms and strengthening digital skills. And finally, financing education was a key. Here we do have a little bit of a diversity because some countries did commit reconfirmed their commitment to the international benchmarks of 4-6 of GDP and or 15-20% of public expenditure to be provided to education, but other did not mention educational financing at all. So it is, we know that all of these different areas that are that countries are committing to require financing. If there's no financing, this will not happen. At the same time, more work is required to support countries in how this can be done. Next one. So as I said in the beginning, and as you know, a number of calls to action were launched that then led to the development of TESS Global Initiatives. So I'd like to speak a little bit to each of these that we have here in front of us. So the first one being Greening Education Partnership. That was launched in response to the need for climate change education in response to the very threatening climate crisis. So within the Greening Education Partnership, there are four topics and themes that will be addressed. The first one is greening learning that looks at ensuring curriculum change to include green education. Greening schools is to ensure that school facilities are climate proof, and then followed by greening capacity, readiness of teachers and policymakers, and finally greening communities to become climate resilient through lifelong learning. All of this has to be measured. So right now, the international community is looking at what benchmarks can be developed. Two have been proposed. The first one is looking at the percentage of schools with green accreditation in compliance with the forthcoming UNESCO quality standard on green schools. So the second global initiative on the list is the Great Gateways to Public Digital Learning. This aims at establishing and supporting a global public digital platform to ensure that every learner, teacher, and family can easily access, use curriculum-aligned digital education content that meets every learner's needs, and while also, and this is an important topic, protect privacy, safety, and data security of users. The Coalition for Foundational Learning is a global initiative that promotes the shared commitment by countries and their partners to ensure the acquisition of foundational learning, literacy, numeracy, but also socio-emotional skills. And here the coalition aims at achieving to half the global share of children unable to read and understand a simple sentence by age 10 by 2030. Finally, the education crisis situation aims at ensuring that children in crisis situations, be it conflict or other, do have access to quality education, and also aims at building a crisis resilient education system. The Global Platform for Gender Equality and Girls and Women's Empowerment is reinforcing the work of UNGAI, so it's an ongoing reinforced initiative. And then last not least, it was very important to note there was a call to action on educational investment and the creation of the International Financing Facility for Education. Today, it's my great pleasure to announce that two more initiatives have been launched. The first one is the Global Youth Initiative, based on the youth declaration that was launched at TES itself, and that really reinforces the continued engagement of youth in the implementation of TES. And secondly, the launch of the Global Commission on the Teaching Profession. So let's follow on with the next one. Okay, so now I'd like to provide you with an overview of follow-up strategies. Now, the UN Secretary General has mandated the SDG4 High-Level Steering Committee to ensure the effective follow-up of the implementation of TES and also the monitoring of what happens. Now, for this, existing mechanisms such as the global education meetings will be used, but also the planned Summit of Futures, which will be happening in September 24, is another opportunity to report on what steps have been taken. Next one. So as a reply to this, the High-Level Steering Committee, together with the Secretariat of the UN Secretary General, have developed a TES follow-up strategy with five pillars. The first one is really looking at the follow-up of the countries at national level that would then ensure that from commitments, actions are really taken at the country level. The second one looks at education transformation to prepare for the summit of the future that I just mentioned. The third pillar is ensuring that the global movement for transforming education that was launched at TES is maintained, and that high-level stakeholders will continue their engagement, be it private sector, private foundations, heads of states, but also the youth-led initiative. Pillar four is importantly looking at the continuation of the transformation of educational financing. And finally, pillar five is looking at how countries can engage with a TES global initiatives. Can we go to the next one? So then the High Level Steering Committee also looked at the different principles of how this follow-up action should be taken. So the first one is the importance of taking a whole of government and a whole of society approach. Now, this refers to the fact that while, of course, TES and all our action focus on education, it is key to also engage with other parts of the government, other ministries, such as Ministry of Health, Ministry of Social Affairs, etc., in order to really ensure that the engagement on education can be carried out. By the same token, it's very important that the entire society is engaged in this transformation. It cannot just stay at the high level, ministerial level, ministries, but it really has to be undertaken by learners, by teachers, by communities, by schools, by families, in order to really reach and get where we are. It is also important to not create a new mechanism. So countries are not asked to develop a new plan or a new structure, but to simply look at what existing mechanisms and structures there are and to strengthen them. So that means to look at, for example, existing national education plans and see how they can be strengthened through the national commitments. The work we do should be evidence-based to inform policy and practice. And one of the key focuses should be to address inequalities and disparities. And finally, as has been said before, the engagement of youth should be at the center of transformation. And we have to continue to engage with the very large movement that has been started with and through TES. Next one. So let's look now how concretely progress can be accelerated at the country level. Next one. So the High Level Steering Committee has developed a guidance on how the first pillar, which is about how to get from commitment to action at the national level, can actually take place. So there are different paths for transformation that have been proposed to lead from the commitment to policies and plans, then from the policies and plans to action, and then finally to commitment, accountability, and action. So in terms of policy and plans, so the idea is to ensure that the policy and plans of every country reflects the political will that has been officially launched at TES to transform education. And it needs to be actually shown in the plan. In order to get there, a dialogue has to be started at that level, meaning with policymakers and planners to see how far the plan corresponds to transformation, to the priorities that were identified in TES, or if certain changes are required. From policy and planning to action, so this requires engagement and discussion with the key actors to actually implement plan. And this is very importantly teachers, for example, but also school managers and local governments that are important for, that are key for developing strategies of implementing policies and plans. And in terms of commitments, accountabilities, and results, well, this will take into consideration the opinions and the needs of all stakeholders, including learners, to follow up on TES. Next one. So furthermore, in terms of accelerating progress at the national level, countries, of course, are invited to translate their national commitments into action and to allocate sufficient public resources and report their progress at the global education meetings. But this cannot be done alone. And so the international and regional community and the UN system is called upon to support them. And so countries and governments should approach and engage with the UN system in their countries, in particular UNICEF and UNESCO, for continued support, for coordination, technical support, and mobilization development and humanitarian partners, but going beyond education. In terms of regional cooperation, it's important to continue with peer learning, capacity building support that can be organized by the regional SDG4 coordination mechanisms and regional offices of UN agencies, notably UNESCO and UNICEF, but not only, of course, but very importantly, all development partners in the country or at regional level. The UN country teams and regional bodies should support their strengthening for education, underline their support with the priorities and milestones of member states. So there will be a need for continuous dialogue between the UN and other development partners and the countries. And there might be a funding window for summit follow-up to be set up in the joint SDG fund to support UNCTs to national governments on task commitments. Next one, please. So in terms of follow-up actions of Asia-Pacific countries, I'd like to give you a very short overview of what has been discussed within the framework of the existing regional cooperation mechanism, which is called the Learning and Education 2030 Plus Networking Group. Next one, please. So we did have a meeting right after TESS last year already. So this is just a snapshot of some selected TESS follow-up activities to support countries. So in terms of UNESCO, we are planning to support capacity building of planners to review and revise their education policies and plans in light of TESS commitments, what I just referred to in the overall strategy, but also to look at diagnostic assessment of learning levels to understand where learners are in their learning and support them in catching up and remediation. Digital transformation is another key area of support, as well as education for sustainable development and global citizenship education to help countries to rethink their curriculum. UNICEF is supporting governments together with partners to strengthen their national education plans with a focus on educational learning, foundational learning very much, out of school children and youth, education technology, teachers, well-being, education in emergencies, and young people's participation. CMEO has many, many things, as you know, that is supporting member states in all CMEO countries. We just had two particular areas, very concrete ones, that we mentioned that we could do together is the Learning Recovery Program, but also the TVET program at Literacy Learning Program, and finally Digital Education Program. Important to note that there's also other agencies that are member of the Learning and Education 2030 Plus group, such as the International Labour Organization, which will focus on TVET and digital skills development, but also green skills development. ASPIR will focus on adult learning in education, and Education International on a global campaign to demanding better financing and investment for the education workforce. Last one. So this is just a bit more detailed information, but I think I'm running out of time. So just to say again that we will be very concretely working with countries to build their capacities in policies and sector planning. Together with CMEO and ASEAN, we'll start a very concrete activity in March to be followed in other regions of Asia and Pacific. Next one. And this is the activity in terms of diagnostic assessment and catch-up measures. Again, this is a very concrete activity that has started in two countries, but will be made available to all countries of the region. So with that, I'd like to conclude my presentation. We started with some activities we started to discuss. We have a long way to go. We are at the midpoint of SDG4. We do have to accelerate. We have to accelerate together. But we believe that TES and the mobilization and engagement through TES has provided us with an excellent opportunity to get there together. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Margaret, for expounding on the commitments and key action points to transform and prioritize education for all stakeholders across governance levels. Now, from a global and regional perspective, we now zoom in to how a country transforms commitments into key actions. Our next speaker is the Director of the International Cooperation Office of the Department of Education, Philippines. Ladies and gentlemen, may I call on the virtual stage Dr. Margarita Consolacion Ballesteros. Dr. Ballesteros, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Emil. Good morning, colleagues in this region of the world. Magandang umaga from the Philippines. And to Margaret, thank you for sharing your presentation this morning, to Director Ethel, to the other members or speakers in this morning's webinar, good morning. And thank you for inviting the Department of Education to share what we have on this side of the globe in response to the challenges of the Transforming Education Summit that was held in New York in September of last year. We know that the pandemic has really inflicted serious damage in our education system, which serves around like 30 million learners. In addition, the Philippines continues to weather several natural and human-made emergencies every year. Following these events, we have observed significant declines in learning among our learners, and even worse, deterioration among our society's most vulnerable and marginalized groups. We recognize that despite our official guarantees, persistent inequalities and disparities of various kinds continue to impede access to quality learning. And as we come out of the pandemic, it is more important than ever that the Philippines, guided by its constitution, the United Nations Conventions on the Rights of the Child, and the Sustainable Development Goals, reaffirm its commitment to education as a basic human right. And our reaffirmation means two things. We must strengthen our current interventions and introduce new ones to address both recurrent and emerging threats to our learners. And second, we must act boldly and ambitiously if our education system is really for full recovery from the pandemic and prepare for an increasingly uncertain future. This morning, friends, I would like to share an overview of the specific action points that the Philippines is very much keen in transforming the basic education. This, however, does not preempt the Basic Education Report 2023 by no other than our Vice President and Secretary of Education, Sara Duterte, which will be held on the 30th of January of this year. Let me begin my presentation by highlighting only some of the key points that the Department of Education has undertaken and has been doing for the last months regarding learning recovery, review of the curriculum and teaching, support to inclusion, and transforming the teacher profession. On learning recovery, worldwide learning recovery is being acknowledged and trumpeted. Hence, we are all concerned on how our learners can catch up. Next slide, please. In the Philippines, various learning modalities were adopted, like, of course, the blended learning, homeschooling, modular, and online learning. but having cognizant of the need to increase contact time of learners with teachers, our Vice President and Secretary of Education has ordered DepEd Order Number 34, Series of 2022, wherein all school, be it private or public, will have to transition into full in-person classes starting November 2nd of last year. We deemed it imperative to have the in-person classes so that learners can come back to the school and maximize instructional time, and with the hope that teachers can easily provide interventions such as the case may be. And for the second one on the review and review of curriculum and pedagogies or teaching, there is this understanding really the need to improve our education outcomes and prepare our learners to be globally competitive. So the department started to review and revise the current K-12 curriculum, of which the whole content of the report next week will be announced at the Basic Education Report 2023 event. The gist of the changes will also be highlighted, as well as on the strengthening of the foundational skills, especially that of reading literacy, as well as the STEM and the senior high school technical vocational livelihood, wherein specialization for learners choosing the TVL track. Part of the changes our learners is to the implementation of learning management and delivery models, such as the distance learning and the alternative delivery modes, or we call it here the ADM. These changes in curriculum and teaching are cognizant of need to be inclusive in our approach to teaching or learning, especially regarding that of those in special context of our learners. And for the support to inclusion, the third one, we have been implementing inclusion programs for years. The DepEd is now keen in strengthening and institutionalizing more of this, such as, of course, the alternative delivery modes. We have been successful in supporting programs through the legislation, such as the case of the Alternative Learning System, or ALS, the latest of which in our fit is the passing of the law, we call it the Republic Act 11650, in which we have started to convert our special education centers into an inclusive learning resource centers, or we call it the ILRCs, and mainstreaming our learners with disabilities in our classes. We also have the Madrasa Education Program, wherein for Muslim learners, we hope to increase the implementing schools through the fund support and that of our people. We call it the Special Education for Indigenous People Education, and engage more culture bearers in the IP communities. As we recover, we acknowledge that any recovery will really be more difficult for some groups that have been gravely affected by the pandemic. And the Philippines have exerted its effort to ensure that inclusion and equity for the vulnerable and marginalized. In a highly diverse country such as ours, we try to strengthen cultural sensitivity in curriculum and learning delivery. We also reinforce the policies that keep our learning institutions free of violence, stigma, discrimination, and exclusion. We are going to expand the alternative learning pathways to cover learners who are not adequately served, and that with the new leadership, we endeavor to intensify our efforts to serve learners with disabilities. And we shall also accelerate the expansion of access to early childhood development for those groups who have not had sufficient opportunities in the earliest. And going to the fourth on the transforming teacher profession, critical to the successful transformation of education is empowered and competent teacher force. We commit to training more teachers in programs and subject areas where they are needed most, in special education, science, and technology, in the early stages of learning, especially that of early childhood development. We also have plans to provide greater incentives for trades practitioners and professionals to impart their experience as senior high school teachers. In the same way, we must ensure that our children, development workers, must also move towards professionalization, and that for us, we don't stop at getting teachers into classrooms, but we are also looking at maximizing time that they spend with learners. And to really achieve this, there is this plan to hire more non-teaching personnel in each school to handle administrative and non-academic tasks. Improving and supporting our teachers are also paramount, hence this has been part and parcel of our work in the department. And it can be recalled that the renewed action on teacher transformation is our push for quality, or we call it in Tagalog or in Filipino, Sulong Edukalidad, which was launched in 2019 by then former Education Secretary Leonor Magdolis Briones, that supports the teachers' upskilling and reskilling. And as part of our strides in transforming the profession, we are happy that we have the Executive Order 174 that establishes the expanded career progression system for public school teachers, which aim to promote Filipino teachers' professional development and career advancements. And it also defined teachers' career lines in our public schools. A very recent passage of the Republic Act 11713 or the Excellence in Teacher Education Act is also very much noteworthy, as it's ultimately will focus on teacher and quality with the hope of improving quality of education in the Philippines. And as part of ways forward, we shall continue to reskill and upskill our teachers, our school heads or school leaders and supervisors, focusing on innovative and inclusive pedagogical approaches as to effectively teach literacy, numeracy, and the 21st century. Next slide, please. On strengthening education, government, and governance and management, crucial to reenacting and sustaining this transformation is really that of reimagining governance, and strengthening it begins with the people, and especially our learners. Our policies, plans, and programs shall be designed with learners and for learners, incorporating their full participation during design and implementation while turning them into permanent partners of change. In fact, during the preparation of the pre-summit in Paris and eventually the Transforming Education Summit in New York, we went all around the country for the national consultation on what they think should be embodied in that statement for transforming education. So the youth were consulted, parents were consulted, even to the point of former education officials and the ministries and even the other government agencies who work closely with the Department of Education. And in response to part of the our commitment, not just reimagining governance and management, the Department of Education Secretary came out for the past 2 weeks with an order number one, series 2023, and we call it the restructuring of the central office, which is the ministry's central office here in the Philippines, wherein there are additional assignments or additional strands where officials should also be working into and dealing with that. These are all related to our commitment to transforming education in this part of the globe. Dear friends, as educators, as we celebrate the 5th International Day of Education 2023, we acknowledge that we still have much more to do, but we only have one commitment, and that is really to improve not just teaching and learning, but also to continue improving ourselves, since all of us as educators, we've got the biggest role to play in preparing our young people for tomorrow's future. I hope Simyo, through the Simyo Secretariat, will do more with us as we move forward to really transforming education in this side of the globe. And I hope that this platform today, through this webinar, we all learned something new. And again, the challenge would remain the same. Let's keep learning and learning and relearning. For as educators or even non-educators at that, we are all lifelong learners. Thank you very much and magandang umaga.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ballesteros, for comprehensively sharing with us the commitments, strategies, and gains in transforming the Philippine education system. To share with us how we can invest more and strengthen implementation of early childhood care and education, we have with us this morning the Executive Director of the Asia Pacific Regional Network for Early Childhood, or ARNEC, ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Evelyn Santiago. Ms. Santiago, the floor is yours.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the Asia Pacific Regional Network for Early Childhood, I would like to thank the Simyo Secretariat for providing us with the opportunity to be part of this webinar in celebration of the International Day of Education. Today, I'll be sharing with you some insights on the importance of prioritizing early childhood care and education as part of a transformative education agenda. Let me just share you my slides. Let me begin by sharing a few things about ARNEC. The Asia Pacific Regional Network for Early Childhood is a network established to build strong partnerships across sectors and different disciplines, organizations, agencies, and institutions in the Asia Pacific region to advance the agenda on and investment in early childhood. We were formed in 2008 by the regional offices of UNICEF, UNESCO, and Plan International. Since then, we have grown into an independent network, drawing its membership from both institutional and individual members. Our primary focus is on sharing knowledge and advocating for holistic and inclusive early childhood development. ARNEC has four strategic goals, as you can see in the slide. These strategic goals signify the purpose of ARNEC as a network. All the strategic goals are interconnected and are essential for the impact ARNEC wishes to achieve. Supporting these four strategic outcomes are thematic priorities, as you can see at the bottom of the slide. These priorities are essentially the focus of all our advocacy, learning, and capacity building initiatives. Early childhood is recognized as the most critical period of development, having a long-term impact on the later stages of an individual's life. Substantial research evidence has acknowledged the significance of quality ECCE on students' later learning outcomes and their potential for higher earnings. There has been a growing body of multidisciplinary evidence on the social and economic benefits of investing in a child's early years, including higher academic achievement, greater economic productivity, stronger communities, more responsible citizenship, and more satisfactory lifelong learning and individual development. There are five indivisible components that young children need to have to reach their full potential as articulated in the nurturing care framework for ECD: good health, adequate nutrition, responsive caregiving, security and safety, and opportunities for early learning. This needs to be supported by enabling environment, including policies, supportive services, empowered communities, and capable caregivers. There is a recognition of the importance of early childhood that led to its noteworthy recognition in the development agenda as a specific target in the Sustainable Development Goals. SDGs put a significant emphasis on ECCE and lifelong learning, while also acknowledging the link between ECCE and equity, productivity, and sustainable development, and therefore a positive and successful future for the children. Target 4.2 of the SDG states, by 2030, ensure that all girls and boys have access to quality early childhood development, care, and pre-primary education so that they are ready for primary education. Despite this global recognition, and 7 years after the adoption of the SDGs, halfway to the end date of 2030, there are still areas where significant effort is required for meeting the ECCE targets in the SDGs. Let's take a look at some of these ECCE challenges in the region based on available data from UNICEF and UNESCO. First, there are only 2/3 of children between the ages of 36 to 59 months who are developmentally on track. Increase in participation of children was observed, especially in Eastern Asia. Despite this progress, however, the participation rates varied across countries in the region due to disparities, especially in terms of location and wealth. Out of the 50 Asia-Pacific countries, only 20 provide free pre-primary education, of which 7 countries stipulated that pre-primary education should be compulsory. Status of learning, of stimulating learning environment at home for young children is concerning, especially in terms of the availability of children's books and playthings for children at home. And as per available data, according to the income group of the countries, children living in high-income countries remain far more likely to be enrolled in pre-primary education than children living in low-income countries, again, demonstrating disparities. These existing ECCE challenges and crises, are compounded by multiple crises affecting young children in the region. This include the COVID-19 pandemic, climate change, environmental risk, such as air pollution, conflicts leading to migration, and many forms of disasters. All of this affect the short-term and long-term well-being of young children, especially those who are already vulnerable to begin with. Let's focus a bit on learning crises due to COVID-19. While considerable progress had been made on ECCE in the region by 2020, many of these gains have been lost due to the COVID-19 pandemic and subsequent lockdowns. According to UNESCO, at the height of the pandemic, at least 7 million children across the region were not able to continue their pre-primary education. 70% of preschools or ECCE centers were closed. ECCE systems were not prepared. The impact of the pandemic on the region's education budgets has been tremendous, with significant reduction on budget for ECCE services. Equally important, but not given enough attention, is the long-term effect of extended toxic stress resulting from lockdowns and health fears, creating a mental health crisis for young children, parents, and teachers. In addition to COVID-19, young children are also exposed to climate change risk, especially in the Asia-Pacific region. The Asia-Pacific region is home to 1/3 of the world's population and more than 1/4 of the world's children, according to UNICEF. To say then that the Asia-Pacific region faces enormous risks due to climate change is an understatement. On the slide, you will see some of the environmental and climate risks that the region faces and the implications on young children. Just to mention a few, rising sea levels due to global warming will greatly affect young children living by the coastline, especially in the Pacific islands. Major flooding are usually experienced in Southeast and South Asia, resulting to loss of lives and displacement of vulnerable population, including young children. Last year, we have seen climate-induced flooding in Pakistan, killing at least 1,000 people and 50 million people displaced. With the impacts of climate change on children and their families, the climate crisis is now considered a child rights crisis. According to Save the Children, millions of children born in 2020 will face, on average, 2 to 7 times more extreme weather events than their grandparents. That means more heat waves, flooding, droughts, crop failures, and wildfires. This puts children's rights to a safe home, healthy environment, healthcare, food, and learning at risk. Given this, it is important that impacts arising from crises such as COVID-19 and climate change are considered when developing strategies towards accelerating progress on SDG Target 4.2. But how do we begin transforming ECCE amidst these crises and challenges? The recent World Conference on ECCE, organized by UNESCO and attended by ECCE leaders from the countries, have agreed on some guiding principles and strategies as they adopted the Tashkent Declaration and commitments for transforming early childhood care and education. There are 4 areas articulated in the declaration: equitable and inclusive quality ECCE services for all, supporting ECCE personnel, innovation for advancing transformation, and reforms in policy, governance, and finance. Translating these commitments in the Asia-Pacific region, key actions that we need to focus on include the following: address the learning loss due to COVID-19 pandemic and the already existing learning crisis amongst young children. Undertake policy-level reforms, especially in addressing gaps in equitable ECCE access. Adopt a multi-sectoral approach to planning and delivery of ECCE services. Have a targeted approach to reach the most vulnerable groups of young children. Upgrade the quality of ECCE workforce. Improve the financing mechanisms, including innovative funding approaches, and strengthen the data monitoring and evaluation systems for ECCE. These are just guiding posts, and transforming ECCE really depends on the commitment from the countries as they prioritize the well-being of the youngest population. In conclusion, I would like to highlight the following. ECCE is critical to child's holistic development. There have been gains on ECCE in the past decade, especially in terms of increase in enrollment, allowing young children to have access to ECCE services 1 year before the official primary entry age. These gains, however, might be reversed by the impact of COVID-19 and other crises, including climate change. Transforming ECCE requires actions on 4 areas as articulated in the Tashkent Declaration: quality and equity, innovations, ECCE personnel, and policy, governance, and finance. Targeted and sustained ECCE investments make economic sense and provide high returns and help young children achieve their full potential. There is a need to increase investments on ECCE, and this requires collective action from all stakeholders. Large part of this, however, depends on the commitment of the countries to prioritize the well-being of their youngest population. Thank you, and for more information on ECD events and happenings in the region, I invite you to visit our webpage and follow us on Facebook. Thank you so much for the opportunity to share with you today.
Thank you very much, Ms. Santiago, for providing key insights on prioritizing early childhood care and education and highlighting also the intersectionality with other key concerns in education, such as climate change. Now, in relation to this, our next speaker will be discussing with us greening education in light of the changes in our world right now. She is a program specialist in the section of Education for Sustainable Development, or ESD, from UNESCO headquarters in Paris, France. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Won Jung Byun.
Hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. It is my great pleasure to be part of the webinar in the celebration of the International Day of Education to invest in people and prioritize education. My name is Won Jung Byun, Program Specialist in the Section of Education for Sustainable Development here at UNESCO headquarters. And today I will be presenting about the greening education and its work that we are planning to do at UNESCO. So in terms of the greening education, it is very much part of the Sustainable Development Goals, especially the Target 4.7, which I'm sure you're very much familiar with, where it enshrines the role of education, particularly education for sustainable development, in responding to the sustainability challenges of today. In particular, this conversation has been taken up very much during the UN Transforming Education Summit, especially around the thematic action track 2 on learning and skills for life, work, and sustainable development. And in particular, there has been some key recommendations that came out of the pre-summit preparation in June 2022, which talks about the role of ESD and the need for climate change education and education for sustainable development overall to be part of the core curriculum component. It also talks about the launch of the ESD for 2030 country initiative and ESD networks to support this activity, as well as the need for schools and learning institutions to be climate proof and ready to tackle sustainability challenges with the daily activities within their institution. So building upon this momentum created around the UN Transforming Education Summit, ESD for 2030 framework is the basis of our action for the next 10 years. This framework, together with the roadmap that had been adopted in 2019, aims to build a more just and sustainable world through the role of education around the 17 SDGs. So the roadmap, in now translated in over 10 languages, can be available on UNESCO's website together with the framework for your reference. In particular, I would like to touch upon briefly about the key features of the ESD for 2030 framework. First of all, there's an emphasis on the education's role for all of the 17 SDGs, as shown on the screen with the wheels and how ESD can support each of the sustainable development goals. The second part is the focus on the big transformation that is needed. So going beyond the individual transformation that education has been traditionally focused on, we now talk about structural changes that are needed in order for us to reach the sustainability goals. This is to raise questions on the systemic issues, rethinking about, for example, economic models that we are promoting in our education system to make it more sufficient, more sustainable, and also to emphasize solidarity in doing so. So in a way, ESD in action is citizenship in action, as called for by the framework. And thirdly, there's an emphasis on member states' leadership to make this happen. And around the five priority action areas that have been continuing from the Global Action Program period on advancing policy, transforming learning environments, building capacities of educators, encouraging and empowering young people and local communities, ESD for 2030 implementation builds around six key implementation strategies of having countries to lead on ESD through their multi-stakeholder platform called ESD for 2030 Country Initiative. Many of you joining today are mostly from countries that are preparing their ESD for 2030 Country Initiative, which needs to invite not only the government experts, but also key partners, schools, communities, and private sector, academia, and civil society organizations and youth organizations around the same table to talk about the role of education. So if you're interested in joining in this partnership within your country, please do contact your ESD focal point or UNESCO office in your region. And otherwise, you're very much welcome to contact us, and we will be able to support you in getting the connections to help support your country's ESD for 2030 efforts. And in building upon that, we would like to organize an inclusive network of partners globally called ESDNet. And there will be a first regional and global meetings happening throughout this year. So for Asia Pacific, it is likely to happen around June, and the global meeting in December 2023. And also communication for action. So now the call for ESD Japan Prize, UNESCO Japan Prize on ESD, has been launched. So very much welcome to apply for this prestigious prize from your organization's efforts. And also tracking issues and trends with research, mobilizing resources, and monitoring the progress are part of the implementation strategy. And within the broad framework and the long-standing work of Education for Sustainable Development, greening in education is one thematic aspect of it, with particular emphasis around climate change and the role of education to tackle climate change issues. I would like to emphasize here that this is not only about environmental aspects of climate change, but also the wider and broad complex impacts of climate change around social, cultural, and economic aspects of our society. So in this regard, it is not to go and imply on environmental aspects only, but covers all aspects of education for sustainable development with thematic particularity around climate change education. The greening education in national curriculums and schools, what does it mean? Now, from our perspective, there are two key issues that are being discussed recently globally. One is the question of access, and the other is the question of quality. So on the question of access, do people, do students and learners get access to quality, good climate change related educational substance in their schools and learning environments? According to UNESCO's recent studies, only half of the national curricula of the 100 countries that we have reviewed make reference to climate change. And only 20-30% of the teachers across many countries across the world can explain well how to tackle action and address action on climate change in their classrooms, even though most of them think that this is a very important topic to think about. And also in terms of impacts of climate change and displacement to the rights to education, climate affected persons face a number of barriers to education. For example, in 2020, over 30 million people were impacted by this, with schools being destroyed and learning being stopped. So access to climate change and education is key. One aspect. And secondly, the quality of climate change and education in greening education is key. For COP27 last November, UNESCO had launched a survey going across and asking 17,000 young people from 166 countries on how they are experiencing climate change education in their classrooms. And over 70% of the young people surveyed said that they don't feel prepared to tackle climate change based on what they learn in their schools. And in particular, one aspect to be highlighted is that the ways of teaching and learning is very much outdated and very passive in the sense of promoting creating of posters, graphs, paintings, which is a very passive form of education on the side of more active activities, going outside the classrooms, looking at project-based learning in their local context, how climate change impacts their daily lives. So we have to change this to make sure that the learners are well equipped with not only knowledge, but also skills, values, and attitudes and action on how to tackle climate change through their educational experiences. So to do this, we cannot do it alone. It's a massive project, and we need to transform our education systems as a whole, as called for by the UN Transforming Education Summit. So to do this, we're inviting countries and key stakeholders, including UN agencies and organizations, to join Greening Education Partnership, a global initiative to bring everybody working on this topic around the same table so that we can create synergies and strategic implementation while avoiding overlap. So this Greening Education Partnership has been launched around the UN Transforming Education Summit and has been discussed at COP27 last year. It has four key components: greening schools, greening learning, greening teacher capacity and readiness, and greening communities with their specific targets. So we will be currently over 300 organizations have signed up to join this, and your organization is very much welcome to join this activity as well. And to further promote, the next steps will be to create working groups around these four pillars and also to invite countries, member states, to come aboard on this Greening Education Partnership to make sure that their country's response to ensure climate change is addressed in education systems are well placed within their education systems. So to do this, we will be organizing an information meeting for member states early February, so next month, and then it will be continuously followed up throughout this year, including at COP28 with a high-level event on climate change and education. So this is a very short overview of what is happening globally around greening education, and we invite you to also check out some of our documents and teaching and learning materials available on the UNESCO website. Also, last year with UNFCCC, we have organized a series of webinars on climate change and education. So you can find that on the link on UNESCO website. And we will do a season two of that series this year from May to December on the road to COP28 with a particular focus on greening schools. So if you come with a good green schools activities examples, please feel free to tell us about your stories so that we can try to highlight it during the webinar series. And of course, you are very much invited to be part of this webinar. So this is a short presentation, and we would be happy to receive any further questions through our email. And I would like to leave you with a quote from a young person from Poland, where the worst feeling is to want to do something about climate change, but you don't have the resources, you don't know where to start and how to get it done. So we need to change this with greening education, and we need to do it together. So we look forward to our continued partnership, and thank you very much for listening to my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Won, for underscoring the importance and impact of greening education in the education sector. Ms. Won mentioned a quote from a young person and her last slide, and we at CEMEO ensures the engagement of the youth and the children in transforming education. Thus, this morning, we have with us the SDG4 Youth Executive Committee representative to the SDG4 High Level Steering Committee to discuss the Youth Declaration on Transforming Education. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Kenisha Arora. Ms. Kenisha, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Emil. It is a pleasure to join you all in the celebration for International Education Day as we mark a way forward for youth to be engaged in the transformation of education, but also the way forward for actually making a difference in education. I'm a firm believer that this is the year for SDG4, and I have no doubt that together we can accomplish this SDG goal. So as some of you know, the Transforming Education Summit was a big milestone for youth engagement in education. It really marked the importance of involving young people, and we saw that for the first time, almost 500,000 youth came together from over 170 countries to engage in the consultations and contribute to the process of the Youth Declaration. Now, for those of you who are not aware of the Youth Declaration, this is a document that was prepared after collecting the voices of 500,000 young people across the world and really listing out what are the clear visions that youth have and asks that youth have for the future of education. What does this future look like to us? who is involved in this future, and how can we work together to ensure that we take the commitments forward. A big part of the Youth Declaration was the Global Youth Initiative, which I'm so excited to be launching today at the United Nations headquarters later on in the EST time zone morning. The Global Youth Initiative is really focused on taking forward the recommendations of the Youth Declaration and figuring out how can we actually turn words into actions, something we often find quite difficult to do in this line of work. But as you know, this Transforming Education Summit was really one of the biggest opportunities to not only bring young people together, see the passion that youth have for transforming education, but also the contributions that youth can make. It's not enough for young people to just be engaged. We need to be participating in the actual implementation of the visions that we have. And so the UN Secretary General's vision statement was really important in launching the voices of youth and the declaration that we came up with. So in terms of creating a global movement, how exactly do we do that? Well, you can see youth have already been doing this. Through our SDG for Youth Network, we've been doing a lot to involve young people, not only to map out a vision for education, but also ensure that youth are actively engaged in the implementation of this vision. So what does this look like in practice? Well, after we set the stage for the Youth Declaration and launched it at the Transforming Education Summit, we've been meeting with all these young people who are passionate about actually figuring out how can we take forward the actions of the Youth Declaration. How do we localize this? Because when we talk about local change, that creates global impact. So regional consultations for youth have been pivotal to our journey of not only developing the Global Youth Initiative, but even taking that forward. And I have the utmost pleasure of working with Dr. Ethel on the High Level Steering Committee. And she's not only a great advocate for youth, but also a champion of getting young people involved in these spaces. We've heard from Ms. Wan Zheng about the importance of educating youth and upskilling them to actually implement change. And we're going to get into that when we talk about the Global Youth Initiative. So more needs to be done. And we know this. Even though the Transforming Education Summit involved youth voices, it was really a moment of young people taking a seat at the table and not really being given one. So what we saw at the summit was the power of youth and the passion that they have for changing our education systems and ending learning poverty that we're faced with, which is why we didn't exactly see this translated in the national statements that came out of the Transforming Education Summit. So there's still a long road that we need to walk through to ensure that young people are engaged in this process. As you can see on the screen, 1 in 5 countries referenced youth and students' engagement in generally in their statements. 1 in 7 referenced their engagements in their national consultations, the importance of consulting with youth, and only 1 in 10 actually referenced the importance of involving students and youth in the engagement of policy processes or governance as well. And that exactly is where the gap is lying. Why haven't we been able to transform education since September? It's because young people are at the heart of this transformation, but we're not oftentimes involved. So the Global Youth Initiative really focuses on taking forward the recommendations from TESS with youth, by youth, and for youth. And overall, this creates a better society for you and me. But how exactly do we do this? The main focus of the Global Youth Initiative is to promote youth leadership and representation. We know that's just the first step, making sure young people's voices are just there at the table. And then the next stage of that is empowering youth to actually become agents of change. At the summit, we heard from so many young people about wanting to make a difference, but not knowing how to start, not knowing where to begin. And that's exactly why this Global Youth Initiative focuses on educating youth about the issues in their community, in their local levels, and how they can get involved exactly to transform education, whether it's through gaining skills about policy negotiation or even just understanding how to build a social movement and spread awareness. This Global Youth Initiative, led by our network, is really going to be pivotal in getting youth to become agents of change. And as we move into a generation of cooperation, this is especially important. So as mentioned, we're going to be launching this officially today, and I hope that you all take a moment to learn more about it then. But the three biggest pillars of this initiative focus on youth empowerment and leadership, youth engagement and participation, and of course, building a youth-led global movement. So thank you all for listening. We really hope to involve you all in the process of transforming education with youth. If you would like to involve us in getting involved with your youth constituencies and figure out how we can best mobilize the youth community, please feel free to get in contact with us through Cimeo or reach out to me directly. And happy International Education Day to you all, wherever you're from.
Thank you, Ms. Kinesia, for reminding us the crucial role of the youth in transforming education systems and making a difference. We are also very excited for the launch of the Global Youth Initiative. And thank you once again for joining us. I know you're live in New York right now for the Global Youth Initiative launch. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Now, we have learned a lot from our speakers and this morning's discussions. Now, to provide us with a synthesis of the webinar, may I call on the Research Evaluation and Assessment Specialist of Cimeo Secretariat, Dr. Kamaleswaran Jayaraja. Dr. Kamal, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Amin. Good day, everyone, and happy International Day of Education to all of you. In the celebration of International Day of Education with the team to invest in people, prioritize education, we have had opportunity to listen and enjoy some of the key significant points from our speakers today. There is a lot of crucial and imperative discussions and key points that was shared with us today. Well, our first speaker, Ms. Margaret from UNESCO Bangkok, on transforming education agenda from commitments to action, discussed mainly on the outcomes of tests, global initiatives, commitments and action plans, overview of the test follow-up strategy, accelerating progress of SDG 4, mainly from commitments to action at country level and the follow-up actions of Asia-Pacific countries. It was certainly interesting to hear the national commitments of Asia-Pacific countries, because most of the countries highlighted that the pre- and in-service training and professional development of teachers are key points to improve the quality of learning. Many of the statements also underline the need to increase teachers' qualification requirements in order to improve teacher capacity and professional standing, as teachers are the heart of our transformation. Our second speaker, Dr. Margarita from Department of Education, the Philippines, on transforming the basic education in the Philippines, explained that the education sector faces many challenges. Because of the COVID-19, children are missing out on school due to the financial issues, social or physical challenges. These problems have also led to a high level of disengagement among the students. To overcome this issue, DPET has made substantial efforts on the learning recovery, review of the curriculum, teaching pedagogy, support to inclusion, transforming the teacher profession, and strengthening education governance and management. The crucial efforts taken by DPET proves that the basic education transformation is inevitable, and it must be carried out for the betterment of an overall and inclusive education in the Philippines. Meanwhile, our third speaker, Ms. Evelyn from the Asia-Pacific Regional Network for Early Childhood on prioritizing early childhood education, shared some crucial knowledge and advocates for children's rights, holistic and inclusive ECD. In fact, it is certainly alarming to hear that children born in 2020 will face 2 to 7 times more extreme weather events than their grandparents ever did. And that means more heat waves, floods, typhoons, more hurricanes, droughts, crop failures, and wildfires. Hence, ladies and gentlemen, we have to begin transforming ECCE amidst this crisis and challenges. Moving forward, our fourth speaker, Ms. Wong from UNESCO Paris, also explained the importance and the true essence of greening education. Greening education has been rooted in the long-standing of work in education for sustainable development, with particular focus on educational role to tackle the climate change. Greening education also equips individuals, communities, and the wider world with understanding skills, values, and attitudes to engage in transformative action for shaping green, low-emission, and climate-resilient societies. However, many of the educators and learners are still unaware of the greening education concept, and they must adapt and continue to increase the knowledge and information for the greening education, which is a crucial item for our future use. And our final speaker today was Ms. Kanisha, the SDG for Youth Executive Committee representative, who gave us some key significant points on the Youth Declaration on Transforming Education. Ms. Kanisha clearly highlighted youth people's collective sense of urgency to address the global education crisis and other simultaneous and interconnected global challenges, such as the COVID-19 pandemic, the climate crisis, growing inequality, conflict, and many, many more. Young people recognize their key role as active agents of positive change in addressing this crisis and ensuring true transformational change, one that is certainly systemic, long-term, inclusive, and most importantly, representative. Ladies and gentlemen, prioritizing education will certainly empower the teachers, education workers, and most importantly, the learners through the provision of equitable and inclusive education. This will also accelerate the SDG achievements as well as prepare schools and communities for the changes and disruptions happening around the world. In short, our webinar in the celebration of International Day of Education has certainly discussed on how to prioritize education in the light of commitments in the Transformation Education Summit, specifically in sharing and highlighting the commitments and action points from the tests, apart from providing the specific action points on ranking education in line with early childhood education, greening education, and of course, the youth engagement. Well, that's all for me, everyone. It has been certainly an engaging webinar. Thank you so much for your time, effort. Thank you so much for being here. Happy International Day of Education once again. Back to you, Emil.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kamal, for providing us with the key points from today's discussion. And now, after a very productive session in the webinar, may I call on the virtual stage once again the CMEO Secretariat Director, Dr. Ethel Agnes Pasco Valenzuela, for her closing remarks. Dr. Ethel, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Emil. Wow, what a lovely day. Again, happy International Day of Education to all. We're reminded that the purpose of education is to replace an empty mind with an open one. And today, we learned a lot. Our powerful speakers have given us remarkable presentations. We have listened to and learned from the experiences, the perspectives, the roadmaps, the key action points from educational leaders on why we need to transform education and how we can prioritize action towards transforming education. However, we also have to look at the current challenges. We are facing a lot of challenges in our very own region in Southeast Asia and all over the world. And the current solutions may be forthcoming. And the recommendations that could address the challenges and strengthening the solutions that we have learned today. As we celebrate the International Day of Education, hosted by CMEO and with our friends of CMEO, we are reminded that at the center of this celebration are the people, the children, the youth, the teachers, school heads, policymakers, and all lifelong learners who can and will change the world. By prioritizing transforming education, we can give a chance to everyone. Is it a second chance? To live the best lives and be their best selves. By prioritizing education, we enable and empower everyone to build the future that they dream of. We at CMEO will continue to prioritize transforming education as we also accelerate CMEO education agenda and supporting the UN Sustainable Development Goals. We hope that this webinar will spark relevant and timely conversations. I have seen a lot of very brilliant ideas in the chat room, and this conversation should be continued within your university, your colleges, your school, and communities. That will lead to more innovation in transforming education. We don't stop after this webinar. We forge on and do our work, but we keep in mind that creative, schools can happen. The best place to start thinking about how to change education is exactly where you are in right now. So we hope that today's webinar will further flame the passion towards reimagining and prioritizing education. And as we end, please allow me to thank all our speakers who generously shared their expertise, their time this morning in Bangkok. It's almost like lunchtime, and we would like to thank you for joining us today and actively engaging with us. For all of you at the YouTube channel, the chat room, it has been very busy. Happy International Day of Education. Thank you very much and have a good day ahead.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ethel, for succinctly wrapping up what we have learned this morning and challenging our participants as well to further prioritize education. Before we close, we would like to invite the youth as part, of course, of our engagement of the youth in transforming education to join the Simeo Youth Network. The network is a platform which will provide the opportunity for the youth to participate in programs, initiatives, and activities by Simeo, and will serve as a venue to share the youth's perspective in transforming education, science, and culture in the region. Kindly scan the QR code and check our website www.simeo.org for more details. We would also like to invite you to the 11th Simeo University of Tsukuba Symposium, which will be held virtually this February 20 to 22, 2023, with the theme Technology and Values-Driven Transformation in Education. Kindly scan the QR code flashed on the screen for more details. And now, before we finally end the program, we would like to announce how to receive the e-certificate, as you may see from the screen. First, please keep your mobile phone handy and get ready to take a photo of the QR code for the certificate validation form. You can also find the link to this form on our Facebook page of Simeo Secretariat. Then please complete the form and ensure you enter the correct full name and email address by the deadline. We would like to emphasize that the deadline is tonight, January 23, 24, 2023, 11:59 p.m. Bangkok time. Please note that you have less than 24 hours to fill in the form. The form will be closed after the deadline, and post-deadline request for a certificate is invalid. We will not be able to fix your e-certificate as it will be generated by the system according to what you have entered on the form. You will receive your e-certificate from us within 1 month, and if you have any questions, please send us an email at certificate@simeo.org. And with this, we end our webinar, and we hope that you take the lessons from this year's celebration of the International Day of Education and work together to transform education. Happy International Day of Education, and thank you, and have a great day ahead.
It's time to open our eyes to a bright and promising future. We'll rise to the call of the times and create a stronger tomorrow. Let's start to make a difference, teaching everyone to learn through science, technology. We will share our expertise. By promoting knowledge and policies, we can build a better world.
Let us take a stand for our visions of hope, making future plans for the people to grow in a life filled with happiness and
goals through partnership, creating opportunities.